We begin a packed 4 days in the liturgy. In fact, we finish our pilgrimage in a profound way with four great liturgical feasts. Today we celebrate the great Marian feast of the Holy Name of Mary. And tomorrow, of course, the great Doctor of the Church, St. John Chrysostom, the 14th will be the Exaltation of the Holy Cross, and the 15th of Our Lady of Sorrows, another great Marian. In some ways, you may say it's a Marian sandwich back to back here. So we find ourselves gathered here to worship in Eisenach, and we gather to worship and to pray. Perhaps we should consider also doing penance in preparation for the unfortunate activities that happened here. In 1522, Father Luther has now been formally excommunicated by Pope Leo X for over a year now, and he's been questioned and refuses to recant or to humble himself at the church trial. So now he comes to Eisenach to hide under a false name of the Squire George. Just want to asterisk, just a casual aside here, that on this day that we celebrate the Holy Name of Mary, it's interesting that we come to a place where Father Luther had to live under the deceitful name of George. What an affront to the name of St. George. We visited his church yesterday, who boldly went forth to fight true evil rather than to hide under a false name, a false identity, while creating a deceitful translation of Holy Scripture. We'll talk more about the Holy Name of Mary here in a minute. But did you notice again? Providential nature of Holy Scripture. Steve just did a great job of planning our pilgrimage each day with readings. Maybe what he did was plan the trip and then he sent to the Vatican the list of scriptures. He's got a lot of connections, so that might have been the easier way for him to have done it. Paul writes to the Colossians, See to it that no one captivates you with an empty or seductive philosophy according to the tradition of men and not according to Christ. So, for us, when we are confronted with seduction, with a seductive philosophy, we are instructed, see to it. We are not captivated. So what's our plan today? I'd invite you to reflect a little on that. If we are instructed, see to it that you are not captivated, that you're not baited by the hook, probably requires, there's a warning being given to us, which means that we need to be ready and be prepared. We might think of, in our own country, right? We've had back-to-back hurricanes in Texas and Florida, and we've had a number of lives saved because of early warnings so that people could prepare and have a plan. Paul is giving us a warning. See to it that you are prepared. Are we? Do we have a plan? September actually is readiness month in the United States for disasters. I think that in declaring September to be a month of preparation, I think it's designed for natural disasters, whereas Paul is speaking of spiritual and eternal disasters, probably requiring a much greater state of preparedness than a simple hurricane. Since we are talking about the theme of names today, I do want to also mention in the homily in the holy name of Saint Elizabeth of Hungary, whose church providentially we get to come and to celebrate. I would love to spend more time. I could just sit here in a holy hour captivating this wonderful altarpiece. Saint Elizabeth lived in the 13th century. She is a princess of Hungary, and during I've had the opportunity to wear America's uniform abroad several times. I've had 5 mobilizations in my military career. One of them, while deployed to a combat zone to the Balkans, we all soldiers in a combat zone get some R&R time. We get a week off of R&R. I got to do my weekend off of R&R in Budapest, Hungary, where I first came into contact with Saint Elizabeth and her fabulous story. And she is the patron saint of this diocese. This is also, we are now in the diocese where Father Luther was ordained in 1507. He was ordained at St. Mary's Cathedral. That cathedral was built on the ruins of an even older church that dates back to 742 and was built by St. Boniface himself, the apostle to the Germans. A long-standing history of this diocese of great Catholicism. And so this is where Elizabeth reigns as patron. She has several miracles attributed to her, and she offers for us a fascinating study of contrasts. Some of the miracles that she is most renowned for, I think in the statue outside as you come in, her cloak out there, you'll notice, features prominently in her statue. So I presume that that is a statue of the cloak of the Miracle of Roses. Now, Elizabeth was a princess, and she entered into a marriage at an early age with Louis, and she lived a fabulous life of royalty, and yet at every opportunity she chose to give that wealth and privilege and resources that she had access to the sick, to the poor. And, you know, when this first started, the palace and her parents and her in-laws and her husband and everybody thought it was, well, that's cute, you know, it's nice that Elizabeth does that. But Elizabeth became more and more bold about sneaking things out of the castle to sell, to give to the poor, and pretty soon people went, where is that candle stick? Has anybody seen all of our silver forks? Where did they go? It started to become a bit of a problem. So one day, Elizabeth has gone throughout the kitchen and gathered all of the bread in the palace. Now, this is all freshly baked bread that's supposed to last for a while. Elizabeth sneaks it all into a basket and she covers it under her cloak. And out she goes, and she's merrily skipping down the lane, and she is confronted by palace officials. Your Highness, we've discussed this. What do you have under your cloak? Oh, nothing, nothing, she says. Cloak, not really. Nothing under here. Let me see it, Elizabeth, reveal. Okay, so she reveals about her cloak, and miraculously, there's bouquets of roses. And she says, see, I told you, it's just roses, I guess. You know, and and the palace officials, of course, were, oh, you're giving flowers, okay, all right, nothing we can say about that. Another time, famously, there was a real shortage of hospital beds. Elizabeth, ultimately, by the way, would spend a large part of her resources building hospitals for the poor. In this particular case, there were no more rooms available for those who were injured, poor, destitute, and there was a leper in need of a place to be cared for. And of course, now leprosy today is no longer, we now can treat leprosy, so it's no longer the contagion that it was at that time, right? But it used to be that you had to have a staff of bells so that people would know when you were coming, and you were actually required to shout out unclean, So St. Elizabeth says, hey, I know where there's a bed at the palace. He can use my room. So Cardamom must take him to the palace, and he can just stay in our bed. And I'm sure that my husband won't mind. what could possibly go wrong with leprosy in your bedroom, in the bed that you sleep in? And so she brings him in, and as you could possibly imagine, her mother-in-law, who lives in the palace as well, doesn't think too much of this idea. There's probably that traditional level of conflict between daughter and mother-in-law. And so the mother-in-law goes, as mother-in-laws are prone to do, to her son, and is chirping at him. And so Lewis is like, all right, I'll check out. So Elizabeth, by chance, is there a leper in our bed? Elizabeth is, see for yourself. And so Lewis goes to the bedroom and throws back the sheets and is astonished to find the body of the crucified Christ himself laying in the marriage bed. And so her husband, Lewis, is okay. All right. Well, I have a saintly wife, don't I? And Lewis ultimately, by the way, gives his own life himself. Killed in the Sixth Crusade, defending the church against radical Islam. And Elizabeth is left a widow. She decides to become a religious and makes her vows and dies, having contracted an illness while caring for the poor, and dies at the tender age of 24. And many miracles began to be associated at the location of or after her burial. I think that in some ways, by the way, Elizabeth, as a young, beautiful, holy woman, presents an amazing contrast for us to consider with St. Catherine, Sister Catherine of Angora, who ultimately abandoned her vows to be married to Father Luther. St. Elizabeth gave her life in service to poor and sick. Sister Catherine of Angora fled her vows to serve the world in prayer. Saint Elizabeth was a saint in heaven at the age of 24, performing miracles here on earth. Saint Catherine, at the age of 26, fled in the dark of night, abandoning her convent and her vows to live a life of sin with Father Luther. Saint Elizabeth and her husband Louis both gave their lives in service to the church. Sister Catherine and her illegitimate husband, Father Luther, devoted their lives to attacking the church that Christ established. What a difference between these two women. The Gospel of Luke continues the theme of naming. In the sixth chapter of Luke, we encounter that our Lord spends a night in prayer, and following that prayer time, several hours of dialogue with the Father, Scripture says he named the apostles. His Holiness Benedict XVI, in his first volume of Jesus of Nazareth, talks about a different possible translation in the English that we could say that Jesus named the apostles,